In this video, we're going to the lab to apply a square wave to an RL circuit, and we're going to read the oscilloscope output in order to determine the half-life of the circuit. Once we have the half-life, we're going to use it to determine the inductance of a commercial inductor in the circuit, and that's the black cylinder you see right here in the breadboard. If you haven't seen the theory video for RL circuits, I'll post a link to that at the top of the screen real quick. And before we go to the lab video, I want to quickly review the essential information we need to perform this experiment. So here's the circuit diagram for the circuit you saw on the breadboard in the last slide. We have a commercial inductor that's nominally 33 millihenries. The internal resistance of this inductor was measured with a multimeter and it came out to 84.7 ohms. And the resistance of our probe resistor, that's the one that's used to produce a signal for the oscilloscope, that was measured at 10.1 ohms. What we're doing in the lab is measuring the voltage as a function of time across the probe resistor. And because that's directly proportional to the current as a function of time through the resistor, it gives us the exact same waveform as the current. So we get a signal like what I've shown on the right side of the screen. And at this cusp at the top of the graph, we have our maximum voltage across the resistor, therefore that's the maximum current through the resistor. And what we're going to do in the oscilloscope is place a couple cursors for the maximum voltage, therefore the maximum current through the resistor, and the minimum. And we're going to take halfway in between that. And when I identify that moment where I've dropped to half of my original current, now I can place vertical cursors. And this horizontal displacement here is the time it takes for the current to drop to half its maximum value. That's the half-life for the circuit. Once we have the half-life, we simply plug into the half-life formula. T1 half is L over R times the natural log of 2. And the R there is the total resistance of the circuit. We then solve this for L, and we've got our experimental value of the inductance. So let's head to the lab and take some data. Today we're in the lab testing an LR circuit, and this little black component right here, that's the inductor. It's nominally a 33 millihenry inductor, but that comes with a plus or minus 10% tolerance because it's very cheap. The resistor in this picture, I just measured as 10.1 ohms by using a multimeter. You can see we've got the breadboard set up already with the long red strip powered. This is connected to the positive end of a power source, and the long blue strip connected to ground. And I've already jumped over from the red strip into the breadboard and from the blue strip into the breadboard. We're going to apply a square wave across this thing, and we're reading the output signal using this compact oscilloscope. This is a Seed DSO Nano V3. They sell for less than $100, and they do the job for just about anything you'd want in a teaching lab. So we'll go ahead and hook up the oscilloscope to the computer. It just connects by USB, and this way we can capture images from it. And we have to hook up the oscilloscope leads into a headphone jack. We get the inductor into the circuit. We get the resistor into the circuit. And finally, we use the oscilloscope leads to measure the voltage across this resistor. And it's important that one side of the oscilloscope leads is connected to ground. It's designed to measure voltage with respect to ground. So that's why we put the inductor first in our circuit and the resistor second in our circuit. Now, when we read the voltage across this resistor, that's a proxy for the current running through the circuit because that current is directly proportional to the voltage across the resistor. So I would normally call this a probe resistor for the circuit. Now, before I get things fired up, we've measured the resistance of the inductor itself in advance of doing this experiment, and that came out to 84.7 ohms. Again, the probe resistor was an additional 10.1 ohms, so you have to add those together to get the total resistance of the circuit. We're going to trust that number and then use the behavior of the LR response to measure the inductance of our inductor. So we go ahead and turn on a square wave, and I immediately see a familiar feature here. So what we're looking at here is the process of the current winding down from its maximum value and then going all the way back down to zero. Just to illustrate what happens if we go to a little higher frequency. I can see that if I hit this circuit with a frequency that's too high, right now it's at 684 hertz, the current never has a chance to get to its maximum value before we begin winding it back down. So we want a lower frequency than that. That in particular gives us a nice flat spot at that maximum, then we can be confident the current has hit its maximum value. That's happening right here. And then the square wave turns off and our current slowly winds down back to zero. Now I'm not entirely sure I've gotten all the way back down to zero, so I'm going to adjust this signal left to right by changing the trigger line. And now that's starting to look very much asymptotic, and I can trust that that current has wound down to zero. Now what we're going to do next is start adjusting the cursors in the oscilloscope so we can figure out the half-life for this current to decay. So we start with our Y value cursors. I'm going to go to cursor one, and you can see that white line moving up and down. I want to put it right at the maximum value. That's the maximum voltage of this signal, and therefore the maximum current across the probe resistor. Then I take my cursor number two, and I move it all the way down to the lowest spot on the signal. Now in the lower left corner on this oscilloscope, it tells me the difference between these two cursors, and that's 416 millivolts. We're going to take half that value, that's 208 millivolts, and move our cursor up until we get to that point. 208 millivolts. And so that's the point where the voltage has decayed by a factor of two. In other words, this is the moment where one half-life is occurring. The current has been dropped to half its original value. Well, we want to measure the time to get from the max value to half that. So we go to our X cursors, and we move one of them to the moment that the decay first begins. Then we move the second cursor to the point where the voltage, and therefore the current, through this resistor has dropped to half its original value. Now the difference between these two time cursors tells us the half-life for the decay, and that turns out to be 272 microseconds. Now that we have our half-life of 272 microseconds, and we've got our internal resistance of the inductor and the probe resistor, we can quickly compute the total resistance of the circuit by just adding these two resistances, and that gives me 94.8 ohms. And we plug into our half-life formula. Again, that's given by L over R times natural log 2, where we're talking about the total resistance in the circuit. And we solve for L real quick. And we plug in our numbers. Remember, micro means 10 to the negative 6. So I could just write this in expanded form as 0.000272 seconds. Our total resistance was 94.8. And we're going to divide by natural log 2. And this gives me 0.0372 Henry's, which we could write as 37.2 millihenries. Now compared to the nominal value of 33 millihenries, I get an error of 0.127 or about 13%. This is almost within the plus or minus 10% stated by the manufacturer, but I suspect we have a small source of systematic error in the experiment. My first thought is that we might try boosting the signal to noise ratio by using higher voltages. But I was being extremely conservative in my approach because I only have four of these inductors in my lab, and I didn't want to accidentally burn one of them. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.